Thanks for this kind introduction. First of all, I'm not that smart. I'm just biting fingernails. I never take cold showers. I'm only good in some areas. And I want to talk to you about a different aspect. I think everybody knows about Cradle to Cradle now. Yeah, I'm here now for 5 years, spending most of my time in the Netherlands. And there is a nice office even in Eindhoven by our institute. Is Sanne somewhere, my colleague? Yeah, so you can go to her, because we want to grow this office to about 30 people in the next 2 years. So whoever wants to start with working with us, just come to us, because we are too slow with what we are doing. Traditionally, people take things, they make things and put them into landfills, and then they think it's environmental protection when they destroy less. Yeah. So it's a very funny way of defining environmental protection. We say, please protect the environment, reduce your carbon footprint. Please protect the environment, reduce your water footprint, reduce your energy consumption. It's like if I would tell you, please protect your child or your wife, beat your child only 3 times instead of 5 times. You're not protecting, you're only destroying less. In that logic, East Germany has been protecting, or Russia has been protecting, the environment so much better than the Netherlands, just by inefficiency. So I was a little tempted to say, hey, is optimizing the wrong transportation system really makes sense? Because if you make the wrong things perfect, then they just get perfectly wrong. Yeah. So from my perspective, I want to talk to you about the energy side. And I have been doing the concept for the Rotterdam dance floor. Yeah. So to say, look, let's make the electricity. And I can tell you, it's a mistake. Because when you make a calculation of somebody taking the elevator or running your computer with your bicycle, if you take the elevator, it takes 5 times less energy than to take the stairs. Because to make a human calorie is about 5 times more energy intensive, even for a vegetarian, than to run the elevator. So who wants to basically protect the environment always takes the elevator. Yeah. And you can minimize your carbon footprint for 80%, and you die a little earlier, you can minimize your carbon footprint even more. Yeah. So there is no energy problem. There's a material problem. People talk about energy, but the material is carbon dioxide. The material is methane. So what we talk about is mismanagement of materials. And because to put carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, when 95% of our materials which we need are based on carbon, this is not very smart. It's mismanagement of carbon. Nitrous oxides are a material. It's a mismanagement of nitrogen if you put this in the atmosphere. And so we have a bigger mismanagement problem of materials. And the energy problem, thanks to Jeremy Rifkin and great work of a lot of people, we will take care of. But the material problem is far more critical. A general material problem, copper is far more rare than oil. Yeah. Indium, germanium, gallium, vanadium, all very rare elements. And we can talk about it. But the energy problem is not solved as well if you don't understand it as a material management problem. Yeah. The Netherlands, Germany are growing corn to make biogas. Yeah. But if you do so, you lose between 11 and 30 tons of topsoil per hectare in a year. So you're carbon negative from the beginning. Because you lose the topsoil, you lose more than in topsoil, when we grow corn, 5,000 times more topsoil than we make. So why do we grow corn to make biogas? Netherlands has the biggest refinery for biodiesel. We import 3 million tons of palm oil from Indonesia. 1 hectare of rainforest has 7,000 tons of carbon. 1 hectare of palm oil plantation has 60 tons of carbon. So we cut down the rainforest to make palm oil? This is stupid. We can do something, but the main question is, what is our role on this planet? Do you want to look at children and it's better you're not here? Overpopulation? Rotterdam, Eindhoven, they want to be carbon neutral in 2050. You can only be carbon neutral if you don't exist. It's the only way. Yeah. So is this your biggest goal? Yeah. You can only have zero emission when you don't exist. Even if you would shoot yourself right now, you would have emissions. So it doesn't help. Yeah. So how can we talk about carbon neutral? Did you ever see a carbon neutral tree? Yeah. There are 600 billion trees still left in the Amazon region. Did you ever hear about an overpopulation problem of trees? Did you ever see a carbon neutral tree? A tree is always carbon positive. So why don't we look at, are we too many? The biomass of ants is about four times bigger than of humans. And because ants only live 3 to 6 months and they never take elevators, they equal in their calorie consumption 30 billion people. So we are not too many, we are too stupid. So it's a management thing. Definitely it makes sense to reduce the use of fossil fuels. But so what? Where is our beneficial footprint? So we talk about a beneficial footprint. When you're in Sweden, your footprint destroys the soil. Or in Siberia and the tundra, it destroys the soil. That's why we try to minimize our footprint. We can do something by legislation that men have to wear high heels, yeah, or like your shoes, for example. Yeah, that reduces your footprint. Yeah. But does it really make sense? So we need to make a beneficial footprint. And that's where we talk about. And that's where we are. It's no longer about efficiency, it's about doing the right thing. Instead of optimizing wrong things and making them perfectly wrong, it's about, yeah, like palm oil, yeah, we need to say what is the right thing first. And look at the tree in spring, no reduction, no avoidance, no carbon neutral, yeah, low carbon, whatever. This is high carbon system. Every waste equals food, using current solar income and celebrating diversity. Sure, we have two different cycles, biosphere and technosphere. Stuff which gets consumed needs to go to the biosphere. Things which get changed chemically, physically, biologically. Things which were just used like a service, like a washing machine, like a light bulb, like a TV set, need to be designed for the technosphere. You don't consume a washing machine, you only use it. So there is no waste anymore. As soon as we learn that, we are not too many anymore. But the most critical thing is phosphorus, you know, phosphate. That's why I want to talk to you about it today. Because it's the most limiting element, and there's far more radioactivity being mined by the phosphate industry than it's used in all nuclear power plants. Far more. Yeah. And it's spread all over the world. Yeah. So we increase our background contamination, make leukemia for children, and we lose all the stuff which we need to go back. So it's about shit what I want to talk to you about. And by the way, this is a clear evidence, yeah, that men are not pigs. Yeah. Because phosphate, every day we need to pick up 2 grams of phosphate. Yeah? And every day we need to release it into the environment. We feel so terrible to be on this planet that there is not one organic label, yeah? Whatever you take, Nature, Progrès, or the European organic label, which allows that our own excrements can go back. It's only organic without us. Yeah? I was in China, in the countryside today, till people expect you after dinner to stay till you use the toilet, because it's unfriendly to leave and to take the nutrients with you. Because you're invited for dinner, not for stealing nutrients. Yeah? So they want you to go back to the toilet before you're leaving. Yeah? So we talk about a beneficial poop print. Yeah, that's what we talk. Yeah? So that's why you can find out that men are no pigs, because traditionally my little feministic sister says men are all pigs. Yeah. And I can show you clearly it's not true, because the phosphate, yeah, which we have in our excrements, yeah, for humans, yeah, the phosphate goes through the urine. Yeah. For pigs, it goes through the solids. So we cannot be pigs, isn't that true? Yeah, So we need to look at phosphate every day. We need to take phosphate in it, and we need to put it in our bones, teeth, etc. Yeah, it's 2 grams a day, and it's the most critical element, because otherwise we could just live as a jellyfish in the ocean if we don't have phosphate. And we don't get enough meteorites from the outside, so we really need to do something. And sure, we use it in a lot of areas, in flame retardants, fertilizers, in all different food additives, etc. It's a really, really critical element. Yeah? And we cannot replace it by anything except we don't have bones. Yeah? If you don't want to have bones, okay. If you don't want to store energy, if you don't want to have teeth. So when we talk about energy, we will be able to collect the sun sooner, maybe a little too late for some areas, but the phosphorus problem is far more critical. So the whole world needs phosphate. Yeah? And who is supplying it? People are complaining about the OPEC, a big cartel on oil. Yeah, but these are 28 countries. Yeah. And by the way, but these are the only countries, basically, which dominate the market. It's the illegally occupied Western Sahara, yeah, by Morocco, and it's China. They control more than 60% of all the phosphate in the world. And they put the price up by speculation and down, whatever. And whenever the price is down, they buy the facilities, you know, the factories, the companies, and then they put the price up again. Yeah. They are the only ones who really understand capitalism. Yeah. So phosphate has a lot of heavy metals in it. Yeah. The main intake of cadmium is phosphate fertilizer. We have legal limits, but the legal limits still mean that the biggest sources of cadmium is by phosphate. And you have the slides, I don't need to go into details. Uranium, just if you calculate it for Germany, in the last 18 years, 15,000 tons of uranium are put into agricultural land, just phosphate fertilizer. Yeah. So, and it gets worse, but there is hope. Yeah, the Netherlands are the first country in the world which says, yeah, I'm proud to be able to say that the Netherlands are the first country in the world to close phosphate cycles. Isn't it nice? So it was 21 years of work behind that. So finally, and thanks to a lot of great people here, yeah, we are successful. And they are heroes. Yeah. So as De Reuter, Carlos Caliano, they are running a company, Sermfos, in Flissingen. They're the only company which actually in the Western world is able to get phosphate back in an industrial system. And I asked Rob De Reuter to come here, that you can see him, and he can talk about this, because we need to get this back. It's the most critical thing, and the Netherlands are key. So whatever you do in other areas, like minimizing your carbon footprint, yeah, if you seal the building, the indoor air quality in the building already 3 to 8 times worse than outside urban air. Now you seal it, yeah, and make the wrong things perfect. And what does it help if you reduce your carbon footprint for 10%? But if you would get phosphate back, yeah, and get it in biological and technical cycles back, yeah, then you would do more to the world than anybody else, because this is the most critical element. This is why Sermfos is so critical. Sure, we need to get phosphate back by nutrient management or Instituto Ambiental, yeah, in Latin America. What we see is we do wastewater treatment to get the nutrients from the wastewater for agriculture. We started 20 years ago. This year we finished 150 facilities. So all the money which we earn goes into these types of products and projects. And so we take wastewater from favelas, yeah, and put them into agriculture. 1 hectare of land can use the wastewater from 5,000 people, and it makes about $1,500 of money out of it. $1,500, yeah. So the farmer can feed his family and maintain the facility. And so we use these favelas, you see biogas, yeah. This is how you grow biogas, you saw water plants. These things are so productive, yeah, that they can do agriculture on 1 hectare of land. Yeah. And the byproduct is clean water. Yeah. And the interesting thing is really the crime rate goes down for more than 90% in these favelas, because if people have a positive future, if I tell you it's better you're not here, then you become greedy, you grab stuff. Yeah? But if I say, hey, look, there's abundance, then people become generous and friendly, yeah? Like you explained with the transportation systems. Yeah? That's why it's not about minimizing, reducing, avoiding, no guilt management, no low carbon, not carbon neutral. It's about celebrating abundance. But for that, we need to get phosphate back. It's the most critical thing. So whatever you do, please support the people who do so. And here is the best news of the whole 5 years. Yeah. It's Gerben Jan Gebrandy and his team and his people. Last week, yeah, the European Commission calls on a commission to make use of the best practice in field of resource efficiency in order to draw approximate criteria to start pilot projects for several resources, for example, phosphorus, which is a view of achieving virtually 100% reuse of the 2020 and optimizing the use of recycling. That was so many years of work. And now, yeah, the European Union decides about it. But without Flissingen, without Sermfos, it's completely ridiculous. That's why we talk about give P a chance. Because this allows you to get phosphorus back. Yeah? So we need to get it back, but it needs all your awareness, all your thinking. It needs all your innovation. So I'm wearing a uniform by von Hansewinkel. Von Hansewinkel is a 70% of the waste management market into Benelux changing into nutrient management. Yeah, sure, they are necessary to get the sewage sludge collected and put it into there. We need to separate, we need to change processes. By the way, this is a service product. You're no longer selling such a uniform, you're selling the use of the uniform. Yeah? So you can use better materials which are good for your skin, not the cheapest stinking stuff which is unhealthy for the people. You're just selling the use of the material. Yeah? So we take market economy seriously. Because right now, the profit is privatized, like with banks, and the risk is socialized. No, we say, if you have the profit, you have the risk as well. These materials can go back into cycles. In Amsterdam, I talked to the mayor, and he said, isn't that great that our whole public transport runs with renewable energy? Yeah. At what? Yes, I said, look, we have this big waste-to-energy plants, and people will always make waste, and so we have energy. It's renewable, isn't it? Yeah. Because waste is renewable, isn't it amazing? If you burn paper, compared to recycling of paper, if you lose aluminum in incinerators, you lose more than 95% of the energy. So the real energy problem is not your heating system, your transportation first. It's non-reuse of materials. And that's why we need to talk about materials going back. And the most important materials of them is phosphorus. So please, let's celebrate all these pioneers. Let's talk about how to get phosphorus back. Yeah. Think about where you can do your own contribution. And if you do so, you do more for humankind than anybody else, because if this element is not going back into cycles, we are too many. Then you look at your neighbor in a car or wherever he is and said, you're my enemy, you're eating my lunch. Yeah? And I asked to be at the end of this presentation because I want to give you the chance to give P a chance. Thank you very much.